have, if you weren't here last week, we are in our series on marriage. We love it, don't we? We love talking about marriage. We love talking about relationships. And God's word is full and gives us a blueprint of how we're to have successful relationships, how we're to have successful marriages. Last week, we talked about that every marriage, every wedding ceremony is a funeral. And when I said that, some of you looked at me and you're like, okay, what is that all about? Well, what would happen is the pastor back in the early church would take this red ribbon and would put it around the couple to signify that you're dying to yourself, that you're going to sacrifice, and that this is what this union is going to look like. And we talked about that marriage isn't this contract that we sign, but it's a union. It's a coming together with the Father, that it's Christ is our head, and we're kings and queens underneath him. And how we talked about that there's a crowning, that when the man and the woman in the ceremony, when they would get married, a crown would be placed on their heads to signify that. And the depth behind that crown is it represented, it was a crown of martyrdom, that you, this life is no longer your own, that you're dying to your will, you're dying to yourself, and you're going to walk out not as two. You walked in as two, but you walk out as one. And so this morning we're going to look at, which I think it's so neat because we're going to be having two baby dedications at the end of service. We're going to be looking at how every wedding is a birth, and we're going to step into of how every wedding, every marriage is a mission, that God has given us a mission. And if you're single, this message is for you. It's going to encourage you. It's going to open your perspective to understand the depth that God has given us in his word. You ready to receive this morning?
Amen.
All right, let's do it. Let's dive in. We're going to be looking at a lot of scripture. So if you need to put your reading glasses on, throw them on, because we're going to dive into the word this morning. Because we're going to look and see what the word of God says. But before we do that, I want to, Kenny, if you could throw up our marriage saying from the early church father, Tertullian. And it was in your notes last week. Hopefully you had a chance to look that over. But this is the beautiful picture that this early church father had given us of what marriage is and the beauty of it. I'll read this to you and you can read along. It says, "Beautiful the marriage of two Christians who are one in hope, one in desire, and one in the way of life they follow. One in faith they practice. They are servants." There's a key word there. "They are servants of the same master. Nothing divides them. They pray and worship together." Congratulations if you're married in here, you just did that. "You pray and worship together, instruct and strengthen one another. Side by side, they visit God's church. They face difficulties together and comfort one another. They have no secrets from one another. They never bring sorrow to each other's hearts. Psalms and hymns they sing, and Christ rejoices and gives them peace. Where two are there, he is present with them. And where he is, evil is not." So this is the beauty of marriage, of this union that the church that God had given us. And as we look, as we step and we look at modern day marriage, we looked at last week of how marriage has been watered down and has been presented as, you know, I'm in wedlock now, so my life is over. That marriage has a bad rap in the world we live in. All you have to do is turn on TV, and I came across this article. It said, "Wedlock is no longer the cool thing. It's more about wed lease." And there's this new idea going around that marriage is, because we know we come into covenant and it's till death do us part. But there's this new thing coming around for young people that are getting married that it's called a starter marriage, where we're just going to step into this. We're going to kind of get our feet wet. We're going to see what it's all about. And then we're going to come into an agreement that after 2 or 3 years, we're going to separate and, you know, go to the next thing. So there's all these things of breaking down the beauty of marriage, of what we just read, and that's what God desires for all of us to be a part of and to experience. And marriage is a mystery. That's why it's the mystery of marriage. A lot of it, you just can't understand because it's not a man-made institution. It's a divine mystery that God had given us, and we get to play a part in that, and we get to experience the presence of God in that. And so the heart behind the series is that you would put down any preconceived ideas Or you would even look at your marriage experience in the tough times, the good times, and that you would just put that aside for the next moment, and that we would look at God's word, and we would take our marriage, take our relationships, take our mindsets, and put them up against the word of God. Because when we step into marriage and we don't really understand what God had given us and how to use it properly, it's just like your phone. If you don't know all that phone can do, you're not going to use it to the fullness of what it can do. And that's how marriage is. There's this beauty and there's this blessing that's in it. But because of the world around us and because of things people have said or things people have done or marriages we've even seen, it's given us a bad taste or a wrong understanding of the beauty of what marriage can be. So my heart for you this morning is, if you are married, that fresh life would be breathed back into your relationships. If you're not married, that you would gain this right perspective. And you, marriage is all about, when you're single, you know, the thing is, I'm always looking for the one. I'm looking for the one. Well, what's taking place is God is preparing you to be the one. We want to always look and say, okay, where's the one? Where's the one? Take a step back and understand that God's preparing you to be that one. Singleness really is beautiful if you can see the fullness of what it is. But our world says it's not. You got to be in a relationship. You got to be with somebody. We look at the big box office movie that just released, 50 Shades of Grey. And look at the record numbers that those movies have had when it was released several years ago, and 50 Shades Darker, that just came out around Valentine's Day. That this movie, tons and tons of people, tons and tons of Christians are going and seeing this, and it's just putting a wrong perspective of what relationships, what sex is all about. It's trying to break down the beauty of what we just read, because the enemy wants to deceive us. He wants us to compromise because he doesn't want what we just read to take place in your life and in your marriage and your children's marriage. And if we can see through the eyes of the Holy Spirit, and we can pick deception, and we can begin to decipher, hey, this is a worldly thing that is marriage, and this is a godly thing. And if we can start pushing back the things of the world and cling to the Word of God, cling to the Holy Spirit, and we can take hold of that, watch as the relationships in your life will be blessed, and watch as marriage in your life will be blessed. Amen. Amen. I want to look at a scripture, Ephesians 5:31, and this speaks to the beautiful union of what a marriage is. It says, "For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh." So I want to break this down, and you've heard it said based off the scripture, is a man is to leave and then he is to cleave. So I want to kind of break this down. I need two volunteers. Caleb and McKenzie, you guys are getting married here this summer, so come on up, give them a hand. So that word cleave, I'm going to use this real quick. Okay. So the word cleave, what it means is, when you break it down, you guys, this will be good, okay? They're nervous. The word cleave is like skin is to bone. That's the closeness that God desires for us to have with our spouse. And so last week we were talking about that early church ceremony of what they would do to illustrate this, to bring understanding of what that oneness, that union would look like. So what the pastor would do is he would take the couple, and you guys go ahead and hold hands, and he would take a white cloth, and we're going to use our baby dedication shirt because we don't have a white cloth with us to resemble this, all right? So go ahead and stick your hands out. And so what he would do is he would take a white silk cloth, and he would put it over similar to that, to resemble that cleaving, to resemble that oneness, that you can't really tell where the man and woman begin, that they're now one, that it shows that they are bone and bone, skin of my flesh, like it says in the book of Genesis about Adam and Eve. So they would do this to resemble that, hey, you guys are one now, that Caleb, your will has died, Mackenzie, your will has died, and now you pick up, by the power of God, a union that is between you, Caleb, and God. Because when you get married, you start off empty. You're a clean slate. And then you start building your life together. All right, you guys did good. Thank you. You're not married yet. Pray for him. How many days, Mackenzie? 100 and something? 104, all right. So that cleaving, that skin to bone, is what God desires for us to have. Scripture's not up there, but Galatians 3:28 talks of that when God views us, and Paul says this, that it's neither male nor female, right? That he sees us as one. 1 Corinthians 7:4 talks of that he gives each man and each woman authority over each other's body. If you go back and read that, it speaks to that. That each man, the man has authority over the woman's body, and the woman has authority over the man's body to resemble that they are one, that there's that cleaving, that there's that closeness. And so this morning, we're going to get into the roles of marriage. And I know I'm going to be walking on eggshells on a couple of these things as we dive into the scripture. But understand that God said it. I didn't say it, okay? There's a pastor who said, my job is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. So that might be taking place this morning. But understand it's coming out of a heart of love and a heart for you to experience this beautiful mystery that God has given us. I thought this was good. Your satisfaction in marriage will be linked to your understanding of God's role for you in marriage. Think of it in your job. Think of it in your schooling. When you know your role and you do it well, things work. There's a chemistry. There's rhythm. There's blessing in your life. The same as in marriage. When you know the role that God has given you, there's going to be blessing. Yes. There's going to be beauty. There's going to be fruit in your life. And so first, we're going to look at the men. And I'm going to go through the scripture, and then we're going to take a moment, and we're going to break it down. And then we're going to look at the scripture of the women and the roles that God has given the women, and we're going to break it down. And if you grabbed your notes this morning, you'll see these scriptures in there, and you can follow along, and we'll also have them on the screens. All right, guys, you ready for this? Ladies, there's no nudging. There's no saying amen. You got to let the men hear this and let it sink in. They don't need your help. I'll help them. And then vice versa, men. No looking at your wife. No nudging them. Let the word of God speak to them, all right? All right, so men. Ephesians 5, Pearline, we'll give that one to you there. You slipped up. No, I'm kidding. You're good. Ephesians 5, 25 through 29. It says, for husbands, this means love your wives, just as Christ loved the church. He gave up his life for her, to make her holy, to make her clean, and to wash her by the cleansing of God's word. He did this to present her to himself as a glorious church, without a spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. Instead, she will be holy and without fault. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. No one hates his own body, but feeds and cares for it, just as Christ cares for the church. So there's our first scripture, and you've probably heard this scripture before. If you're married, it was probably right at your wedding. But we all know at our weddings, things are just all over the place that you never really hear what the pastor is even saying. You're just so excited to get married. So this is just a little refresher. 1 Peter 3:7 says, for the men, in the same way, you husbands must give honor to your wives. Treat your wife with understanding as you live together. She may be weaker than you are, but she is still your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Treat her as you should, so your prayers will not be hindered. All right, so there's scripture addressing the men. Now, ladies, you ready for your scripture?
Yes.
All right, thank you.
Read aloud.
Read aloud, okay. I don't control my volume, so. All right, so 1 Peter 3:1-6. The funny thing is we're going through Ephesians and 1 Peter. These are really where scripture is shared of the union of marriage. And it's kind of funny because Paul, the Apostle Paul, he wasn't married. And Peter, he was married. And he gives a lot of scripture to the wives. I don't know why, but we'll see. 1 Peter 3:1-6. In the same way, you wives must accept the authority of your husbands. Then if some refuse to obey the good news, your godly lives will speak to them without any words. They will be won over by observing your pure and reverent lives. Don't be concerned about the outward beauty of fancy hairstyles, expensive jewelry, or beautiful clothes. You should clothe yourselves instead with the beauty that comes from within, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is so precious to God. This is how the holy women of old made themselves beautiful. They put their trust in God and accepted the authority of their husbands. For instance, Sarah obeyed her husband, Abraham, and called him her master. You are her daughters when you do what is right without fear of what your husbands might do. Ephesians 5, 22 through 24. For wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For a husband is the head of his wife, as Christ is the head of the church. He is the savior of his body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so your wives should submit to your husbands in everything. All right. We made it. I'll let you read that, Pastor Webb. You know, as I was studying this and looking into the deeper meaning, you know, ladies, it's tough when you hear that scripture when it says submit, submit, submit. You know, we live in a world that's all about power struggle. He's not going to tell me what to do. She messes up, I'm going to prove to her that she was wrong. I'm going to make her feel it. You know, there outside of Christian marriage, there's power struggle that goes on between marriages. And there was people outside of Christianity will say that the Christian view of the woman isn't pro-woman, isn't pro, you know, the woman gets to make a choice. They have to submit under that head of their husband. But as I was looking into it and finding out the depth and the context of what it was spoken to, it was really insightful, and I believe it's going to bring light to this word submit. So I'm going to go back and forth and highlight different areas of scriptures for the men and bring depth to it, and the same with the women. And so in Ephesians, when Paul was addressing, it was first century when this was being addressed. And if you look what the role of women in first century, it wasn't good. If you go and you go back, you study, women were seen as a commodity. Women were seen as property. They had no rights. They couldn't really be out in public life. It was almost very similar to how the Muslim religion is and how Muslim men view women. So it wasn't a healthy environment. The man had the authority. The man said what went, what didn't go. And so this was the context of the time that Paul was sharing these things in. And so when Paul was saying this to the men, that men, you're to love your wife, you're to cherish her, you're to nourish her. How many of you think those Roman men did not like what Paul was saying? Because he was coming in and literally changing everything up from how that culture, that first century, that Roman culture was at the time. A Greek writer described the first Roman century culture as this. He said, "We keep mistresses for pleasure, concubines for day-to-day needs, and a wife for a legal guardian of our children." So the wife was basically just a nanny to raise the kids. There was no mutual respect. There was no mutual authority. There was no equal between man and woman at that time. So this is the context of what Paul is sharing this in. And he's really saying this to the men, that, hey, things are about to change because of what Jesus did. Paul says these things again, to love and to cherish them. And here's what's neat about Christianity at that time. Christianity was the only place really where women had rights. When the Christians gathered and they went to church, it was really the only time a man and a woman could sit together in public. It was the only time where a slave and master could sit together, the rich and the poor. Nothing was segregated inside the church. So the church was setting this example in culture that was completely different to anything outside in Roman culture. Think about that. It's pretty cool. And so this idea that women are underneath the man in the Christian view is not true. when Paul addressed all these things in Peter, they were causing an uprising to how men and women should be treated and what the man's role is in a marriage and what the woman's role. That women don't just take care of the kids, but they're an equal with the man. It's good stuff, isn't it? Ladies, you can say amen to that.
Amen.
And so that word submit, if it makes you cringe and you're a woman, you got to understand the deeper meaning because there's so much depth to this. And I can't share it all with you this morning, so I want to really challenge you to get in, to study it, and really figure out what it means. You know, as I was studying, I felt the Holy Spirit put on my heart that men, if we would really take our marriages serious, our family serious, in the way that God called us to do, you would be shocked, the revival, the rejuvenation, the things that could break out in your lives and in your family's lives. Because God has made us head. But here's the head is. Jesus Christ is the head of the church, right? And the church is like the woman, is the bride. Do you feel like you're under the thumb of Christ as you're sitting here in church this morning? So that's what Paul is describing it should be, is that men, we should be like Christ. You should be almost as a priest in your family. And then woman, you're that bride underneath where you're working together, but you don't feel oppressed by the man. We live in a society that men want to control the woman. They tell you what you can and cannot do. That's not the marriage that God has desired. That we are equal. There's that oneness. And that's why the priest, when he would put that cloth over, he was basically saying, you're one now. You are connected. This is deep, and this is for the men. It says, husbands have a great responsibility. And we're talking about driven by eternity. We're understanding the judgment seat of Christ so that we can be confident when we die and we stand before the judgment seat of Christ and we give an account for our lives. We can't take a U-Haul with us. Nothing else comes. Our lives are naked before Christ and we're judged for the things we've done. According to Scripture and what the church fathers say, husbands, you need to hear this. It says, husbands have a great responsibility. They will be judged not only themselves, but on the spiritual, emotional, and physical condition of their wives and of their family. God has put you the head of that church. Take it back to, or the head of that family. It's just as God has put pastors and leaders as the head of the church. And if you read the book of Timothy, there's a judgment for anyone that comes up here to teach that they're going to have to give an account of anything that comes out of this pulpit. Anything I'm saying to you, I have to give an account if it was wrong, if it was said in a wrong spirit. So anytime I go to prepare, I pray and I check and I do because I know that there is a judgment, a double judgment for me being right here and speaking into your life. The same is with us as men as head of our homes. We have to take serious this role of being a husband and of being a father. But the world around us wants to paint family as it's done. It doesn't work anymore. You get a starter marriage, you get a starter family. That's not the way Christ intended it to be. So men, understand that. And he tells us to love as Christ loved the church. What was the love of Christ? We hit on this last week. It was unconditional. It was sacrificial and it was full of mercy. That's how we're to love our wives and to love our family. Unconditional, sacrificial, and full of mercy. When you think of Jesus, there was no one who came into contact with him that did not feel fullness of love. Even when he was hanging on the cross and the two thieves, the two sinners that were beside him, they felt that fullness of love beside Christ. Even when the Pharisees, the religious rulers, people who hated Jesus Christ, look at how Christ always responded. He always responded in love, even to those that hated him and put him on a cross. He said, forgive them, for they not know what they do. That's the kind of love, men, that God wants us to be. We established last week that our marriages bring out the things in us so that we can be healed, so that we can be made into the image of Christ. That's why this journey, this life, is not just a ticket mentality. I get this ticket salvation, I'm good, and I don't ever have to go to church, I don't ever have to learn, I don't ever have to study. It's an invitation salvation into understanding what you were born to do, understanding the call of God in your life, understanding of what a husband is, understanding what a father is, a mother is, what a wife is. You are invited into breaking the curse of sin off of your life. Because the world around us is sin-craving, it's sin-natured. And it's the church, just like that early church that understood what marriage was, they turned the whole world upside down of what a woman is and what a man is. And we saw a whole different example that was never seen before. God wants to use us to show the world what marriage can be. But unfortunately, Christian marriages, a lot of the times, you look at statistics, they're no different than marriages outside of the church. Where's the disconnect happening? It's because we don't understand the beauty of it, of what we read, and we don't understand the roles that God has given us. Because when we're in that role, we're in that sweet spot, we're living the way God created our marriages to be, and our families are being blessed, our kids are being taken care of, our kids are blessed. You know, men, you might have had this complaint before in your life. She doesn't submit to me. She's always arguing with me. She's always coming up and rubbing me the wrong way. When you have that argument, we have to ask ourselves, am I being a man even worth submitting to? Because if I'm not a man worth submitting to, why would I ever expect my wife to submit to me? It's tough, but it's true. You'll see in a place where you can fill in this blank of what love is for the man. Love is sacrifice and to cherish. Your role as a man is to sacrifice, and it's to be cherished. You're to cherish your wife. But here's what you have to understand in marriage. When you're saved and you're walking with Christ, even before you get married, those things should already be existing in your life. Because that's who Jesus was. That's how he taught us to be. He taught us to be sacrificial. He taught us to love. He taught us to cherish. And so when you have those foundations established in your life and you're already operating in them and how you're serving and your job, what you're doing, then when you step into marriage, it really just goes to the next level. You just kind of take a step up. And so single people, be practicing these things because it just gets heightened the minute you step into marriage. And it's put to the test. And men, our role again is to sacrifice and it's to cherish. We look at Jesus. He didn't shout his love from heaven. He said, love your neighbors, love your friends, do good. What did he do? He became stinky flesh and stepped into our world and modeled it for us. He just didn't shout and say, hey, do this, do that. I'll be watching over you. He stepped into it, became a man, died a terrible death, to prove to us what love can be and that we can attain that in our life. And that's why, again, we establish salvation as healing, and it's a healing process, making us constantly into the image of Christ, that we never step out of that journey, that you might feel you've failed or you might feel you've messed up. But that's when you step back in and you allow that healing process to begin and you start changing what's coming out of your mouth. You start changing your actions and you start to see your marriage change. You start to see your life change. A righteous man falls down seven, but what? He gets back up. Christianity is all about getting back up and understanding that the strength of God is with you and his grace is going to empower you. Right. Amen. Oh, amen myself. Yeah. You know, I thought this was good. Husbands, we love to be the hero and we say we would do anything for our wives. I will climb that mountain for you. I will take a bullet for you. Anybody ever said that to their wife before? The thing is, take it a step deeper. Those are the easy things to say and do. But would you turn your TV off for her? Would you maybe change the tone that's coming out of your mouth? Would you spend some time with your kids? We talked of last week. When you get home and you have the work hat on, it's our responsibility. We got to take that off and have to put our dad and father hat on. Not taking the cares of the world. Now, that's just going to happen. We're human. We're going to mess up. We're going to get angry. It's been a long, rough day. But we have to be self-conscious of it and understand it. Men, when's the last time you've opened your Bible and read scripture with your wife? When's the last time you've come together, held hands, and you've prayed together? These are basic things that will change your marriage and will invite the presence of God into it. That's why Jesus says, it's dying daily. The gospel is dying daily. It's not a one-time death. It is a daily grind. It is a daily death. And the minute we step out of that, that's when selfishness comes in. And it makes us make wrong decisions. And we're looking out for me. And that's where the power struggle comes into the marriage. We have to understand we have to die to self each and every day. You'll see in your scripture, and for lack of time, I won't share this, but you can read 2 Samuel 12, 1 through 5, and he talks of where David was confronted by the prophet Nathan after he had had an affair with Bathsheba, and as because he had that affair, he had sent Bathsheba's wife out, or Bathsheba's husband out to be killed in the line of battle because he was ashamed of what he had done and he wanted Bathsheba for himself. And so the prophet Nathan comes in and he shares this story, not knowing that this story is about David. And David's response was, David said, "I'm furious. As surely as the Lord lives," he vowed, "any man who would do such a thing deserves to die." That's when Nathan said, "This is you, David." And what he's sharing is the shepherd and a sheep, and how that shepherd is Christ. And ladies, you're that sheep, and you've been cared for by Christ, and Christ has taught you and has watched over you and has cherished you. And men, when we see our wives that way as that precious sheep, and that we're called to take care of them, that we're, when we get married, again, what that early church ceremony looked like, you weren't just making vows to husband and to wife. You were making a vow to God, saying, "I'm going to cherish her. I'm going to watch over her. I'm going to be with her." You're making a vow not only to her, but to God. And that God has given you that little lamb to take care of and to watch over. Your wife is a daughter of the kings. That's why they're seen as a king and as a queen, and a crown is put upon them. Because you're going to, if the president of the United States walked into the room or any office of honor or power, you're going to react a little differently, right? The same. That's why the king and the queen, the husband and the wife, are viewed that way. Because men, you are talking to a queen. Women, you are talking to a king. So you're going to react and treat that person that God has put in your life differently. It says that women are a weaker vessel. That's not a bad thing. But where we've seen marriages go awry is when men use the strength that God had given them in a wrong way. They bully her. They control her. That's why he says you're to use your strength to protect, to watch over her, to care for her. You know, men, we also want to say, you know, my job is I provide, I bring food home, I bring money home. What more else do you want from me? I've worked all day and I've worked hard. Again, that's where we've got to step out of that role and understand that's just a part of it. And this is where it's tough when we take our cross, that we have to be a father and we have to be a dad and a husband as well. So for lack of time, we won't hit the woman. Kidding, we're going to talk about the women. Can't leave it there. The men won't let me make it out alive. So ladies, when it talks of submitting, you know, I want you to, if you see in your blank, fill in your blank on your notes, what submit means is to honor and it means to yield. The neat thing is the most Christ-like thing you can do in your marriage is to submit. It's pretty cool. And we established that Jesus gave us the model of what submission looks like. Could you imagine if you heard Jesus say or heard a scripture that said Jesus didn't want to submit to the will of God for his life? Right. Make the Holy Spirit do it. He needs to submit. I don't want to submit. I'm done. I'm tired. You look at the whole life of Jesus. He was in full submission the entire time he walked the earth. And that took him to a cross. Again, submission is a part of Christianity. And that's why we die daily. That's why we submit daily to Jesus Christ. Look what Philippians 2, 5 through 7 says in regards to submission. It says, you must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. And here was the reward of it, Philippians 2, 9 through 11. Therefore, and here's what's neat, because of Christ's submission, ladies, hear this, because of your submission in marriage, therefore God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name above all other names, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue declare that Jesus Christ is Lord. Again, imagine if Jesus didn't submit. You can't. Jesus submitted in everything he did to God. Looking back at Scripture, I love what 1 Peter 3 says about the beauty of a woman. It says, don't be concerned about the outward beauty of fancy hairstyles, expensive jewelry, beautiful clothes. Ladies, our culture puts so much pressure on you that you got to look sexy. You got to look good. You can never let yourself down. There's this image you always have to be portraying. And it's pressure. And it's tough. And that's what he's speaking to here. Verse 4, he says, yes, that comes, but don't make that image your priority. He says, instead, close yourself inside with the beauty that comes from within. How do we gain beauty within, ladies? You pray. You seek God. You pray for your family. You pray for your husband. You pray for yourself. You invite the presence of God into that home. And it says, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. Look at this, which is so precious to God. It's beautiful. You know, when it says in Ephesians that for a husband is the head of his wife, it's not elevating the man as head over his wife. What Paul is doing is he's elevating the responsibility of the man is, men, look, you are the head over this family. And that's when the fear of God should hit every man when you read that. That outside of Christ, I can't lead or love my marriage. I can't love my children the way I'm supposed to do. It almost sets you up to fail within yourself, so you have to rely on God. And then you rid and empty yourself, and you fill yourself, men, with the love of God so that you can be that head of your family. And then women, if men would live that way, you would say, I will gladly submit underneath that. You will have no problem. Ladies, I would guarantee you would even run after a man like that. But men, it takes sacrifice. It's not easy. It comes at a cost. And ladies, submission is not easy, and it comes at a cost. It's tough even, but look what it said in Scripture, that your submission, if you have a man that isn't doing what he's supposed to do or isn't even saved, your submission could lead that man to Christ. That's how powerful your submission is. So if you're in a marriage where you're not equally yoked at this point, we're believing that that can change, your submission can be the gospel to your husband. That's beautiful, and that's a powerful tool that God has given you. You getting a little more understanding this morning? Can you see why this principle turned marriage upside down? Think if the world today understood what marriage is. Most people getting married, even in churches, outside of churches, they don't understand what these roles are. So the minute they step into it, there's so much strife and conflict, and that's why you see divorce happen so quickly. I just can't take it anymore. It's not worth it. This isn't what I thought it would be. She wasn't what I thought it'd be. She was beautiful on the wedding day, but what happened? There wasn't an understanding. We fall in love with the wrong perception or this wrong idea of what marriage is. But like we said last week, marriage is meant to sanctify and to save us. But there is a great reward in marriage. We have to understand that there is a beautiful reward, and that's what we're going to get more into next week. It's been building up into the beauty and the blessing of that God desires to give all of us. But if we can do our job, if we can do what God has called us to do, even when the other person doesn't. Ladies, you have to trust that even if your man isn't worth submitting to, that you have to trust in the power of God. This is what he's called me to do, and I have to trust when I do submit that God can move versus when I don't. Because you're underneath his authority. You're underneath the power of God, and his strength will come upon you to do it. Think of all of us in our Christian walk, the things we have to submit to. When we desire to be in the house of God, getting up early, getting to church, reading our word, it's not something that just, oh, I can't wait to go to church this morning, or oh, I can't wait to read my word, or oh, I can't wait to serve my wife or to serve my husband. These are things that we have to discipline ourselves to do. Our flesh isn't bent toward any of these things we just read. So we have to discipline ourselves. And so I want you to see your spouse differently, that they're not the one causing all the aggravation and all the strife. They're the one that God is using to heal the crazy inside of you and vice versa. Amen.
That's the best thing you said.
All right, good. Y'all are more quiet than I'm preaching this morning.
And ladies, lastly, we're going to look at the scripture that's on your notes. You're probably like, why are we talking about this? Proverbs 27:15 says, a quarrelsome wife is as annoying as a constant dripping on a rainy day. Get that right there.
I'll leave that out.
Proverbs 25:24 says, it's better to live alone in the corner of an attic than with a quarrelsome wife in a lonely home.
Yes, sir.
Ladies, there's some big scripture here. That's why, ladies, your role again is submit, is to honor, and is to yield. To break quarrelsome down, it means don't be disagreeable. Don't be argumentative. Don't be quarrelsome. That's what that means. Don't always argue. Bring that spirit of peace into your marriage and into your family.
You can do it. And when it submit means to honor, ladies, it matters how you talk about your husband in public. How you talk about your husband behind their back. When you get together with the ladies, how are you talking of your husband? Are you saying encouraging things? Or are you saying, he did this and he did that? Are you talking down about your husband? Because men, we desire to be respected. And when you respect your man, he will climb the highest mountain. He will go the farthest distance. He'll go to McDonald's and get you ice cream if he feels that respect. Do you see the tools that ladies God has given you and men that God has given you that if plugged in right, man, you're going to have a beautiful marriage. But when that power struggle gets in, it throws everything else off. And we start disagreeing, we argue. Honor and yield. Yield to what your husband says. Now, submit doesn't mean that when you come home, it's a long day, you sit down, and that question comes up, what are we going to watch tonight? That the man always gets to pick. That's trivial. That's petty. It's about bigger things than that. That you just don't take what the man says all the time. Because the man has to understand that there's a sacrifice and there's a cost. And you should always be looking for the needs and how you can serve each other. We talked of last week that marriage is that box that when each and every one of us put in, that this overflow will start to happen, and that's where we live out of marriage. Not I go in and I take this and I take that, and before you know it, you're on empty and there's nothing else to take, and that's where the devil comes and compromise comes and then affair comes, pornography comes, sin comes, and then the devil has got you by the throat. And he starts to tear your marriage down and starts to pull you away. There was a story I came across that talked of compromise because compromise, I've said it before, sin comes in a tailor-made suit. Usually you don't even see that a temptation has happened to you. That's how good the devil is to deceive. But that's why we have the Holy Spirit where we can see it. there's a story of compromise that I want to leave you with this morning. And I actually want to read it to you to make sure you hear the fullness of it. It says, Eskimos in the barren north often kill wolves. I always have a tough time with that word, Brie will tell you. They always kill these wolves by taking... Just flow with me on this if I say it wrong. I'm already walking on eggshells, so what does it matter? Wolves, thank you. So they kill this animal by taking a razor-sharp knife and dipping it in blood. So they take it, this razor-sharp knife, and dip it in blood. And they would stick the handle of that knife down in the snow. And they would allow the blood to freeze to the blade. And they bury the handle of the knife with the blade exposed. As the wolf began to lick the blade, his tongue would become numb and desensitized due to the cold. As he continues, his tongue begins to bleed and he starts to lick even faster, unaware that he's consuming his own blood and slowly killing himself. Within time, the Eskimos return and bring the dead animal home. And here's the principle here. In the same way, the enemy numbs us. He numbs your marriage. He numbs your relationships through compromise. Within time, we, like the wolves, don't realize that we're dying and dying spiritually. The enemy desensitizes us until we are numb unto the things of God. You might be sitting here and you don't even realize it, but you're so desensitized in your marriage that you don't even feel there's hope. Or you don't even feel you can get up out of that pit. That's why we talked of it at the beginning of the year. This is going to be a year where you're rising up out of pits in your life, where you're not dealing with compromise anymore. You're not going to settle for lesser things. We are going after a God who is so big, who is so mighty, who is powerful, who breaks the chains, who sets the captive free, that there's anointing we can receive here this morning for hope and life in our lives. Amen. I'm telling you, revival can break out in our families and in our world if marriage would go back to the way God intended it. That it wouldn't just be a place to go, it wouldn't just be a place to run to because it's just what I'm supposed to do or I'm just supposed to have kids. It's so much more to that. God has a specific mission for you and your spouse. But like anything in your life, when you go to buy a home or when you go to buy a car, you research, you study, you do all the grunt work to make sure you're going to get the best deal. You just don't stumble into a car or into a house. You put the groundwork behind it. Single people, start preparing, reading, studying. Find marriages that you see that inspire you. Sit down, talk with them, go out to dinner with them. Find out the key to success. In the marriages that I've talked to, the number one thing is self-sacrifice. Die to self. Do not be selfish, because selfishness always wants to ruin. So I challenge you, go back, reread these scriptures. Don't read them to your spouse. Get in your prayer closet, read them to yourself, and watch as it starts to become alive to you.